Hi everyone, I'm Gabriel Scherer, the fellow on the right, Peter on the right, and I'm going to talk about unfolding ML data type declarations without loops, which is joint work with Nicolas Chatin, the fellow on the left. And this work was done as part of Nicolas' internship supervised by me. So in this talk, we are going to talk about an OCaml feature that we wanted to implement. This was Nicolas' internship's topic. And as part of this implementation work, we discovered a more general problem that applies to any other programming language, that is how to unfold recursive type declarations in a terminating way. And I'm going to explain first the feature and then the more general problem and how we solved it. So the feature is an extension of constructor unboxing. Since about 5 years ago, OCaml allows single constructor unboxing. So if you have an algebraic data type with a single constructor and a single parameter, you can add this unboxed annotation to add that at runtime, the constructor is not used. It's compiled into the identity function. It's not represented. And this makes the representation similar to a type alias or synonym. But the type is incompatible. You have to explicitly use the constructor. This is nice. Actually, for most programs, not representing the constructor, not boxing the value, does not make such a performance difference. But in some rare cases, it is important. And it satisfies people who want to write zero-cost abstractions. So they want to know that their costs do not occur any change in the runtime representation. And then last year, Jeremy Yalop proposed an extension of this form of constructor unboxing, where you could unbox one constructor among several others, or even several constructors in the same time. So here is an example. I define a type of big numbers as either actually a small number, which is just the int type of OCaml, which is 63 bits wide, or a big number, which is represented by a DMP integer. DMP being a library for big numbers. And this representation is nice because if you know that the two inputs to your addition function, for example, are small, you can use the in-language addition, and that's faster than calling for the DMP addition. But to get actually a performance win out of this, you want to unbox the small constructor to make sure that the small integers are represented just as primitive integers and not as box values. So in this case, it makes a big performance difference. And the reason why it makes sense to forget about the small constructor here is that the two set of values, so integers on one side and this big of GMP.t, are disjoint. So OCaml uses a tagging scheme. Many languages do that and the details vary. In OCaml, there is one bit in the value that tells you whether it's an immediate value or a pointer to a block on the heap. So even if you forgot about small, you can use this tagging bit to distinguish the two cases. So now, to allow for this feature in general, we need to define a check that this, to accept unboxed annotations and to reject some of them that would be problematic. That would be problematic because if you forget about the constructor, in their case, the values on both sides would not be disjoint anymore, so there is a risk of miscompilation. So to check that two types have disjoint representation, we use an abstraction of the set of value, which we call the head shape. So we first define the head of a value by two information. So first, whether it's an immediate or a block, and then a number. Z in this talk represents machine integer. So the head shape of an immediate value is, it's an immediate, and then the value itself. And the head shape of a block is the tag. So in OCaml, when you have a block on the heap, it contains some information, the tag, that is a sort of runtime type information that is used by the garbage collector and also by some runtime services such as comparison and serialization. Okay? So for example, the foo literal string, the head shape would be that it's a block and that its tag is string tag, which is 252. So the tag is 1 byte. And now we define the head shape of the type as the set of heads of any of its values. So So in particular, if you have two types whose head shapes are disjoint, then its values must be disjoint, because heads are a function from values to a smaller representation. So in the big num example, if you do not use any unboxed annotation, well then the small constructor will be represented with a block, the tag 0, and the big constructor will be a block with tag 1. But if you do use the unboxed annotation, so this is accepted because the compiler can check that the shape of small of int unboxed is just any immediate value, so it's the shape of an integer, and the shape of big of GMT is all the values in the set are blocks of tag 0. Okay, so the two head shapes are disjoint. This is easily checked, so we allow this definition. So in particular, the disjointness you need to implement pattern matching. Okay, so before in the usual standard compilation strategy, the pattern matching compiler to check whether we are in the small or the big case would know that it has a block, get the tag, and check whether it's 0 or 1. With the new compilation strategy, we have to look at the shape and we say, oh, actually, the shape of some small constructor which is unboxed is just immediate. So I can check whether I have small or big by checking this tagging bit to know whether I have an immediate or a block address. Okay, so we can still compile pattern matching definitions. And the fact that we use heads as the argument for disjointness means that at runtime, we only have to check the heads of the value to tell which constructor we have, which guarantees that, okay, they are disjoint and there is a efficient runtime way to check disjointness and to compile pattern matching. So the high-level idea is that constructors are a way to enforce disjointness of values of hypothetical data types, that any compilation scheme that preserves this disjointness is admissible. So now comes the question of, okay, so at compile time, you see a definition that contains some unboxed constructor. You want to check statically that this disjointness criterion is preserved. So you need to compute the head shapes of your types. How do you compute the head shape of a type? Here is an example. I have a type alpha tree. So the trees are NRE trees. When I have a node, I have one value for each subtree. Okay, so it's just a bizarre form of tree used for this example. So a tree is a node, and the node contains a lazy sequence of pairs of a value and a subtree. And because I can, I mark this node constructor unboxed. Okay. So to compute the shape of an int tree, and let's go in the other type definition. A sequence is either nil, the empty sequence, or a func, so it's weirdly lazy sequence. It's a func of that will once forth give me the first value of the sequence and then a subsequence. And then I have some type foo that is either an int tree with some unboxed foo constructor or something else. So I want to check that the foo definition is valid, so I need to compute the shape of foo of int tree and then the shape of the rest and check that they are disjoint. So to compute the shape of int tree, what a natural thing to do is to go look up the definition of tree. Okay, I see that it is a type with a constructor that is unboxed. So the shape of int tree will be the shape of whatever I get by expanding this sec constructor. So I go, at type int times int tree. So now I need to go look at the definition of sec. And I see that there are two constructors, there is nil, or there is this next of blah, blah, blah. So I can recursively compute the shape again. And at this point, so nil is a constant constructor, no parameter, and the representation is OCaml is as the immediate zero. And the thing on the right is a function type, so I do not need to compute the shape of the argument. There is some shape of function, so specific tags which did not function and nothing else. So now I have computed the shape. One thing that is worth noticing is that the core operation I've made is to, okay, look at the head constructor of the type, go read some definition, and in this definition, replace parameters by type expression. And this is precisely a beta reduction. So actually what I'm doing is I'm computing some normal form with a call by name reduction strategy in presence of arbitrary recursive definitions. So it does not look like the typical syntax of function programs like lambda terms, but actually these are terms that with well-defined beta reduction. And what I'm doing in this example is repeated beta reduction until I end up on some sort of normal forms, which are types whose shape I can decide without looking at the shape of their subtype. Why do I say that it's called by name? Well, look at, for example, in this example, into entry sec, I will go and expand the definition of sec before trying to normalize the argument. For example, int 3 here, I don't need to touch, I just expand the head thing. So this is the call by name reduction strategy. And as you probably know, computing a normal form of a term in presence of arbitrary recursion is not, well, some terms do not have a normal form, some terms loop indefinitely, and a priori it may not be decidable whether a term terminates or not. So for, here is an example, synthetic example, I'm sorry. So the type T contains an unboxed occurrence of U, and U contains an unboxed occurrence of T. So if I try to compute the shape of T or U by using this approach of repeated expansion, so at compile time when checking the program, I would loop infinitely. So the question is, okay, how to compute this normal form without looping? Yes. So normal form of a type modulo type aliases and these unboxed constructors. So this is useful to compute the shape of a type, which is what we need to do in our particular program. But it's also useful in other type analysis in the OCaml compiler, notion of immediacy and so on. And it's a problem I think of general interest. So any language could want to do some analysis based on the normal form of type expression after unfolding definitions. Okay, so it's a more general problem. And the first idea is to say, okay, let's forbid cycles in a very simple way. So ML family languages have type synonyms or type aliases, and these are typically not allowed to be recursive. They cannot refer to themselves, or you cannot have a mutually recursive nest of aliases. Because that corresponds to, if you want, after expansion to infinite type expressions. More precisely, when you have a cycle in a mutually recursive set of types, that maybe some of them are aliases and some are algebraic data types, well, each cycle must go through at least one constructor of an algebraic data type to be accepted by the language. So we could use the same approach here to consider unboxed constructors as just synonyms, and to say that these unbox constructors do not count as cycle breaking in this sense. The problem is that this is too restrictive. So in the example that I used before, for example, this criterion would reject the type definition. You would say, okay, tree is used within its own definition, and there is only an unboxed constructor between the definition and the use type. So this is a cycle I reject. This is not so good because if I did not use the unboxed annotation, this would be accepted. And the idea is that users start from exact existing type definitions, declarations, and then I want to stick the unboxed annotation in some cases where it makes sense from a compilation point of view to get performance benefit. And they don't want the code to start being rejected for a totally different reason of cyclicity. And here, actually, if we expand the definition of sec, or if we at least we look up the definition of sec and we reason about it, we will see that the occurrence of A3 inside A3 is not problematic. Okay, it will not create an actual cycle when expanded the definition. So there is no good reason to reject this definition, and it would be problematic in practice. So this static criterion that works without expanding anything, we reject. Then there is another idea that comes naturally, which is to, okay, just do repeated head beta reduction, but keep track of the set of types that you have seen in this reduction sequence. Okay, And if you see, if you reduce, you expand the type, and you see, you get a new type that is the same as one of the type expression you had before in your reduction trace, well, you have found a cycle and you stop. Okay, of course, if you do see something that gets repeated, you really have a cycle and you really should stop. The problem is that there are some definitions for which that will loop and for which you will not see a cycle. These are called non-regular recursive definitions. So here I have this alpha bad example that is a loop of alpha times alpha bad. So if you take int bad, you expand it, you get int to int bad. And you expand it again, you get a larger type. And you will get an infinite sequence of larger and larger types that never repeat themselves in the sequence. So your criterion does not prevent non-termination. So this fails. And then an idea is, aha, I do not get the same expression again and again, but I get the same constructor at the head, a type constructor bad, that repeats many times, which is probably the sign that there is a cycle. So I instead of tracking whole expression, I should track head constructor. Okay. The problem is that this is too restrictive. Here is an example. I define a ID type, which is a parameterized type, which is equal to its parameter after some unboxed ID constructor. And then I define the type foo as foo of int ID ID. And this, if you try to expand it using this termination checking strategy, you will stop thinking that you have seen a potential loop. Okay, so you start with foo, you haven't expanded anything yet. You expand foo, so the expansion trace is foo, and you get int ID ID. And now you expand ID, and the expansion trace is now foo ID. And the type that you have is int ID. So the head constructor ID already occurs in your expansion trace. And so the algorithm will stop and say, oh, there might be a cycle here. But in fact, there is no cycle. And you rejected a perfectly valid definition. So this example is very synthetic. But in practice, it will occur that some type definitions are used as auxiliary definition to add some extra bit of information. And these auxiliary definitions, they could show up twice along a cycle, okay? And there is no reason, along a definition, there is no reason to forbid them. And they will be used in actual programs that people care about. So this criterion is too restrictive. And then the final iteration of this approach, which is the one that we used in the end, is to say, instead of tracking the set of constructor expansion that I made at the head of my type expression, I will track an expansion context for all sub-expressions. Okay? So let me show you with an example. I took this ID-ID example and I made it slightly more interesting. So now we have int delay here. And delay is just something that expands in one step to ID, which again expands to its parameter. Okay, so just a small wrinkle in the definition. So I start with foo, and this expands to int delay. And for each sub-expression, so here, int, which is type expression, I remember that it occurred first when I expanded foo. And then int delay, the whole sub-expression int delay, it occurs first when I expanded foo. And then int delay, this whole sub-expression, it occurred first when I expanded foo. So the parenthesing is a bit subtle here. And so now I have an expression, type expression, and all sub-expressions are annotated with the idea of where are they coming from. And when I expand this delay, so alpha delay expands to alpha ID. So the alpha int foo delay foo, I keep unchanged. And then this ID here, which is some new part of the term, I remember that I got it by expanding foo and then delay. So each time you do an expansion, you add a new constructor to the trace of the new parts of the type expression that you get. And then when you expand ID, you get alpha, so you get exactly the parameter. And here, nothing new appeared because of the expansion to ID. So there is no ID. There is no ID left in the trace. So then what we get is what we had at the second step, int foo, delay foo. And when we expand this delay, which is now in head position, we get ID in the expansion context, foo, delay. And when we expand this, this vanishes and we get int foo, which is a normal form. So here, It's the same idea of tracing expansions, except that the trace that we store on each sub-expression remembers when it first occurred in the expansion sequence, and not where we are, what the expansion we have done right now. And this difference accepts this example and makes the check much more expressive. There are more recursive definitions that are accepted while remaining terminating. If you have an actual batch cycle instead of two innocuous occurrences of delay, it will show up in the trace and you will stop detecting a loop. So, Stephen Dolan remarked that this algorithm is actually the same as the one used by the C preprocessor, CPP, to guarantee the termination of macros, macro expansion, you see. So if you want to find a very unreadable, informal textual description of this algorithm, go read the C standard draft. Proving the termination of this algorithm is surprisingly tricky. So it was done in GitHub, so Nicola and I thought of a proof and we wrote it as a GitHub comment, and then Stephen Dolan found a bug in it, and we proposed a new proof, and then he found a bug again, and again, and I think at the third or fourth iteration, I complained in frustration to Irene Vasperger, who proposed a stronger argument, which we, and at this point, we had the proof that everyone, Nicola and I, Stephen and Irene, were happy about. So this is really a collaborative development. And now you may ask, well, is it complete? What are the definitions that would terminate but that you reject? Of course, there is no sound and complete criterion for the termination of call by name terms with arbitrary recursion, general call by name lambda terms, because it's a Turing complete language and so it's undecidable. But in fact, if you look at the terms that you get as ML type definitions, they have the property that the parameters of the type constructor are all first order. They are of kind star, never of some higher kind. So as lambda terms, they correspond to a first order fragment of the lambda calculus, in which, for example, you cannot define a fixed point combinator. And I believe that this criterion, termination criterion that we use, is in fact complete for the first order lambda calculus with arbitrary recursive definition, but it's not really important. Why is it not? Because whether or not you allow higher kinded parameters is a design choice in your language. So in general, we cannot consider that this criterion is complete. I mean, at some point you will extend your language and it will become incomplete, so you should rather think of it as incomplete. But it is incomplete, but it accepts the definition that people want to write today. And I think a good deal more, which is good enough for us. Once we get a richer language, and if there is a use case where this criterion is too restrictive, we can think about expanding it. But for now, we are very happy with that. And actually, we think it is complete for OCaml today. Okay, so this is the end of my talk. To summarize, we worked on unbox constructors, which is an optimization, a representation feature that requires some static test analysis to detect whether it's valid or not for a given data type. And this required us to work on the problem of normalizing type declarations, type expressions, in presence of cyclic references, cyclic type declarations. Thank you. Do you have any questions?